Hey, good evening. Thank you for joining us this evening at our November 19th regular board meeting. We are having some trouble, as you can see. The audio portion of our meeting is working, but we are having some trouble transmitting between cameras and the Zoom. So if you are online, you can hear us. We have translation available this evening. If you are in the room and need translation services, we have headsets in the back of the room. Just let us know. If you are online and need translation services, please note on your screen the circle at the bottom and press that, and you will have translation services.
Buenas noches. Sorry. Buenas noches, bienvenidos. Perdón por la tardanza. Estamos teniendo dificultades técnicas, pero si necesitan servicio de interpretación, esta junta va a contar con interpretación simultánea. Si están presencialmente en la sala, pueden pasar a recoger los audífonos con la señorita Mandy Dawson. Ella está en la parte de atrás del salón. Gracias.
Thank you. The board met in closed session immediately prior to open session, and we discussed anticipated litigation and personnel matters. Do we have consensus on the order of business this evening? Good. Okay, thank you. So our first item this evening is one of my personal favorite parts of the meeting, and that's 5.01, our student representatives to the board. And San Luis Obispo will go first this evening.
All right. Thank you again for the opportunity to be here. It's always fun. I think I'm going to be the person who's coming to these meetings out in Loams from now on. Linda's going to come to the ones in the district office. But all right. It's easier now that I don't have to go off of the screen anymore. I don't have to worry about the projector. So this week in Slo High, we're having Gratitude Week. And basically, in the spirit of before Thanksgiving break, we want to give students a chance to express their gratitude on campus. And each day this week, we're going to be doing a different event, basically to express our thanks to people on campus, to our peers, and things like that. On Monday, yesterday, we had Thank a Teacher Day. Students could write a message to their teacher about what they're thankful for, basically say they're thankful for any number of reasons for if they help them, or basically just a way to show appreciation to your teacher. And then Tuesday today, we had a gratitude challenge. It was a challenge put on by our Wellness Center, where basically in our third period classes, we'd have basically every student write on a sticky note, again, something they're grateful about. And we're gonna create like a whole mural and collage of all those sticky notes and put them up for people to look at. Tomorrow, we're having a gratitude tree. We're gonna have a paper link chain of things we're grateful for. Thursday, we're gonna have a grateful photo booth where if you find a friend on campus that you're grateful for and you're friends with, you can come down and before school and at lunch and take a picture with them, get a little thing, remember it for a while. And then on Friday, the end of the week, we're having a gratitude challenge raffle. Basically, if you participated in any events this week, you can go to the Wellness Center and get some prizes. All right, and then additionally, I'm going to report on our DPLA, the Leadership and Community Service they've been doing on. They're a group of students that do work at Love Pacheco on Saturdays, and recently they did a whole bunch of work, and we wanted to say that that was great, and they've been putting in a lot of very hard work as well, so it's great for them. Additionally, our next thing on the list was SEMA, and SEMA was a automotive industry convention that students from Slo High attended, basically where they could work with professionals, business owners, future industry professionals as well, and basically get experience with the workforce, with industry, learn about auto and all that stuff, which was a great opportunity for a lot of students. So one senior said, quote, "It was a really great learning opportunity and experience that opened my eyes to the possibilities in the automotive field." So it was a great thing that a bunch of our students attended. Additionally, in terms of our athletics, we've had a lot of great success. Girls tennis won second year in a row, Division I Central Section for state. And then after that, they did I believe the individual portion of the tournament, and senior sisters Audrey and Marley Conover teamed up to become the CIF Central Section doubles champions. So that was great. Girls volleyball as well went to state playoffs for Division One. They made it past the first round, but sadly lost in the second round to the one seed. So we really can't be that upset about that. And then, of course, the season came to an end. So it's a great, great program. We're extremely proud of them as well. Boys water polo made it to the CIF semifinals, fell to Redwood, ending their season as well. And then football, again, made it far in the playoffs. They won their first round and then traveled to Century Valley Christian and lost to them in a very narrow game, 21-14. So tough loss, but really good showing. All right. In addition to that, we had a few of our students as well recently attend the CHOP Classic down in AG. It's the first inaugural Central Coast CHOP Classic, basically a culinary competition. We sent two teams consisting of three guys and two girls, and they were basically presented with a bunch of ingredients blind, and they said, all right, you got an hour or and a half or so to basically come up with a meal. And it was a great opportunity again for those students to basically get some hands-on experience competing, working with culinary, and then they were evaluated by a blind panel, or they were blindly evaluated by a panel of four professionals. To kind of close this off, some upcoming dates we have for Slo High is on December 10th, we're having a Slo High School jazz concert. Our jazz band's going to be holding a performance on December 16th. We're having a holiday band concert at the PAC. It's going to be a lot of fun. We also have a Slo High School choir concert the day after that on the 17th. This week as well, we're holding a canned food drive for the holiday season. It's a spirit point competition. All the classes are competing against each other to bring in a bunch of different canned foods. If you're still a high school student and you're watching this, you can drop it off in front of the wrestling room. And lastly, to end my little report, since finals happened very recently at Slo High School, we ended first trimester. We have some data on grades for that. And compared to first trimester of last year, we had 23% fewer Fs, 18% fewer students with Fs, 5% fewer Ds, 8% fewer students with Ds, and 11% fewer students with Ds or Fs. So more students are passing their classes, being more successful. So that's great. And we're really happy about that. And that concludes my report. Thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you so much, Leo. Thank you guys again for having us. I'll be presenting the first part of the Morro Bay presentation, which are our clubs. Our fall play, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, wrapped up this past weekend, and it was an amazing success. I went. It was amazing. There was a lot of fun British accents the whole time. And we are extra thankful for our student director, Emerson, who did a wonderful job with the show. Anyone who saw that production and was amazingly impressed with it, as I was, this spring you'll be looking forward to their new performance, which will be Little Shop of Horrors. And this Thursday, we'll have our FFA chapter degree banquet in our theater at 6 p.m. And Surf Club had several surfers make it into finals, and everybody scored very well. So we're very proud of them and what they've done this season. So passing it to Zahira now.
Hello, guys. Hope everyone has a good night. So in regards of ASB, ASB hosted the student recognition luncheon last Thursday and was really great. Each teacher invited two students that they wanted to recognize, and they enjoyed a taco bar at lunch, and ASB served them. The staff at MBHS are having a Friendsgiving this Thursday at lunch, although this is not an ASB event. It just sounded cool, so we wanted to mention it to our. And a big thing for ASB right now is preparing for the week after Thanksgiving. We are heavily focusing on our winter formal that is the Friday after we get back from break. So we're really deep in that right now. The theme is Northern Nights. It is organized by our sophomore class, and we're so excited to make it all happen.
Another amazing thing about our winter formal is it'll be the first student DJed Morro Bay High School dance. So we're wanting to branch out more and get more student engagement with that. And so we're hoping for that to be a great success and to continue on in the future. And now moving on to sports, for those of you who are unaware, our girls water polo team won a CIF title on Saturday. This is the 17th CIF championship in Morro Bay High School history. To put that,
17 años que la prepa de high school ha ganado.
Right now, our team is playing at Lee High School in San Jose in the first round of the state
playoffs. Ahorita nuestra prepa está jugando con un equipo de San Jose.
No live scoring, but we're hoping that they're going to do great. And we sent the team off today with the drumline, a police escort, and our mayor. And our football team last Friday beat Atascadero in their latest CIF game, 42-14. So a pretty big victory for them. And our football team is the only Central Coast team still in the playoffs, and they head to Bishop, California for the semifinal CIF game this Friday. Last year, the team traveled to play at Bishop and lost in the last minute by 1 point when we failed on a 2-point conversion. We're hoping to change that this year and get a nice win this Friday. And winter sports have started. We had our parent and student safe sports meeting last night, and teams are kicking off competitions this week. I believe girls basketball has a scrimmage tonight, and Thursday boys basketball has a game, I believe, against Madera South. So we're looking forward to see what those teams can do.
And lastly, on an academic note, on a very special note, Morro Bay Seniors of the Month for November and December were announced, and the two pairs were Rowan McCain and Zahira Segler for November and Nate Landwehr and Stephanie Loza for December. We're very excited for that, and we love our students. We are recognizing ourselves here, which is kind of funny. And another few events that are happening around our school is on the 3rd, the FFA Slow Section and Creed and Big Contest was at 4:30, and then I don't know what the rest of this is, but I just believe it already happened, just like recognizing what our FFA and all of our clubs are doing. So thank you for being here tonight and listening to us talk about our schools.
You guys are fast. You were especially quick, fast speakers tonight. Yeah, we really appreciate you, your flexibility in being able to give the reports. They're thorough and informative and entertaining reports without the benefit of video tonight. So as always, it's great to know all the things going on. And I appreciate both the having the academic piece in there as well as all the wonderful extracurricular things going on. So thank you. As always, obviously, there's much going on at each of the high schools. So if you feel that you would like to press on with your evening, feel free to do so. As always, you're, of course, welcome to stay. So thank you very much. We next have 5.02, which is Monarch Grove Program Highlights.
Thank you. Oh, wow. Here we go. Booming. Mrs. Leilani Green is our student support specialist. She provides, individualized supports to students who need it most. She's also coordinating with teachers and with intervention specialists to provide students with what they need. Thank you so much for getting that chart up. What you're looking at here is the product of her work and the product of teachers' work in just one trimester. You can see that our students who are at high risk in this, I'm sorry, I should back up a little bit. This is assessment data from our FastBridge. It's an online assessment tool to determine where students are at in their reading level. The gist is we, in just one trimester, have increased the number of students who are reading above grade level by 10% and reduced those students who are below it significantly. So we're gonna continue to track these data. Mrs. Leilani Green, again, is great. Our teachers are excellent. It's such a good staff, and I'm blessed to come into this situation and be part of the team. And hopefully support more learning for students. Moving on to the counseling corner, we have Mr. Mason Rodriguez. He is, in addition to his daily duties, providing once monthly lessons to all classes in social emotional learning. So that includes regulation strategies, that includes dealing with conflict, including others on the playground especially. He's doing a great job with our students and providing some of those proactive supports. He's also manning our student leadership program for fourth and fifth graders and doing a great job with that. Moving on, quick update on Measure D. We are so thrilled. We got our two new modulars in. Teachers have remained resilient. Kids have remained resilient in the face of construction. And really just we're focused on how excited we are for the future and what it's going to be like to have basically a brand new school. Just a little tidbit from our Prop 28 funding. You can see our third graders were inspired here by the hit song Wigs from the B-52s and got very creative with some of their portraits. Just wanted to share that. Not a long one, but all of our students are getting that art support. Moving on to our PTA support, and I really want to give a heartfelt thank you to our PTA president, Mrs. Anna Waterworth, who's made my transition really smooth as well. I mean, anything that's been asked for from the school to provide support to our students, she and the PTA have given. That includes music lessons for transitional kindergartners through third graders. That includes providing lessons through One Cool Earth for gardening, which is so important for science, and just getting outside and working with your hands. There's so many other great events that they've put on. I've had the ability to go to the Monarch Mingle and fall Halloween dance and saw a lot of SpongeBob costumes there, which was great. We've got our winter festival coming up soon too, and I'm sure you'll all get an invite. Just a couple other highlights before I go here. You're looking at the third grade class there at the beach on the left. They were doing a beach cleanup and learning a little bit about our local estuaries and their involvement and commitment to that. And then you see some more garden time with One Cool Earth. And then of course, our fifth grade buddies working with our second graders on some science activities. So passing on their knowledge and advice and support. I wanna say thank you one last time. And I also want to just say, like, I felt so supported even in the short time that I've been here. That extends to the board, that extends to the cabinet. I really appreciate everything. I'm looking forward to a great year and hopefully many more to come after. So thank you.
I see Mr. Unger's light on.
So one of the things we'll be talking about tonight is the SPSAs. And I just want to say that Monarch's SPSA was really impressive. And the progress that you're making toward closing the achievement gap is laudable. And congratulations on all the hard work you guys are doing.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's a, and I would just add that we really appreciate having you here. I haven't met you personally. I just as one person been kind of steering clear of Monarch a little bit until things get settled. You know, I know that there's a lot of transition going on, but we appreciate Mr. Mayfield, Mr. Block, you in making it as easy as possible for the students and their families to feel like to know that they have a home there, even though there are other some people coming and going, and we're really looking forward to having you there 5 days a week.
Oh, so I identify with that.
So thank you so much. Yeah, thanks. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you. Tonight. Thank you. I really appreciate it. Yeah. Nice to meet you all, and thank you for letting me speak tonight.
Next is a presentation for our outgoing board member, Dr. Prater.
Good evening. I thought there was like a little music startup for me.
A little prelude.
Getting all motivated. Good evening, board. I'd like to take this moment to express my gratitude to Trustee Eve Hinton for her service to the San Luis Coastal Unified School District over the past 4 years. Eve has been a steadfast champion for the importance of parent partnerships, always advocating for policies that are inclusive of families, ensuring their voices are heard and valued in the educational process. Her thoughtful approach has consistently kept the focus on what truly matters, creating a supportive and inclusive environment for both students and their families. With 3 decades of experience as a bilingual educator and a publicly elected trustee, Eve brought a wealth of knowledge and perspective to our board. Her career has been one of commitment to students, families, and educators who support them. Her advocacy for teachers and administrators has been equally strong, recognizing the vital role they play in the success of our schools. Eve is someone who has always been reliable and honest in her approach. She has earned the respect of those around her, not only for her ability to stand firm in her beliefs, but also for her willingness to consider different perspectives. Even when those perspectives diverged from the majority, Eve had the courage to voice them thoughtfully and with care. And of course, she always did her homework, ensuring that her decisions were grounded in knowledge, personal conviction, and understanding. From our local community here in San Luis Obispo, to the annual conferences at CSBA, to Washington, D.C., Eve has represented San Luis Coastal with honor and integrity. Her work has had a positive impact, always advocating for the best interests of our district, our families, and its students. Eve, your time and dedication to this board has made a positive difference. On behalf of my cabinet team, thank you for your leadership, your integrity, and your commitment to the betterment of our schools. We acknowledge and appreciate the work you've done as a trustee in the San Luis Coastal School District. We hope you enjoy your future travels and all the great things you do with your husband, Steve, and I hope you stay in touch. Thank you.
I'd like to see if the board has any comments. Anyone from the board before we take a little break? Mrs. Roger.
I don't have prepared remarks, Eve. So I'll just speak extemporaneously to you. Although we probably don't agree on most political things, I have found having you serving on the board with you to be a really good experience for me, and I think for our board, that to have a divergent view or divergent views is what makes a board good and causes a board to work and look at things and question. And I appreciate the way you have always been firm in your beliefs, but very professional and and dedicated, and there's no question that your heart is in the right place for students. And personally, I like you very much, and I'm going to miss serving with you. So I just wanted to tell you that.
Well, thank you, Mara.
So I've had the fortune of working with Eve, with you, on a subcommittee. And the subcommittee is the board policy committee. So this committee gets to look at the policies that run the school district before the rest of the board. And we sit and discuss them. My other partner on the committee is Ellen. And having the perspective that you brought to those was amazing, but it also let me work with you sort of up close and personal. And I've really enjoyed that. And then the other thing is that Eve sits to the left of me at board meetings. And I've always enjoyed the little stuff that goes on at board meetings that nobody can see. So thank you very much. And Eve always puts kids first.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mr. Clausen.
So as the newest board member and just getting to work with you for the last year and a half, being new to the board, there were some things that you really showed me that I don't think anyone else showed me as part of this experience. I think first one was the importance of parental communications and engaging parents. I think you have been an advocate for that and demonstrated how important that is. And that's something that, you know, as a recent parent, I maybe took for granted, but being in a board seat, understanding your advocacy for that and the importance of that, I think was really meaningful and made a big difference. I also really appreciate your advocacy for CTE programs and for financial literacy. And I think those are things that we need to keep pushing hard for. And so I think your voice here really helped me get my feet under me as I joined. And I think you've brought some really important perspectives and programs forward that I think we all need to keep in mind and keep advocating for. So
thank you.
Thank you.
I'm glad to hear that. Mr. Banfield.
Well, I'm going to miss you sitting next to me. I think some words that come to my mind that describe you, if I might. Integrity. Not a fake bone in your body. I mean that. And courageous. You stand up for what you believe. And you've been both polite and professional about that. And I can just feel the love that you've had for the children. So I'm going to miss that.
Thank you.
Well, I'll miss you too.
Eve, I'm just going to add that I think you've made me a better board member. I think your views have been important to be heard. You represent a voice in the community that deserves to be heard. And I appreciate that. I appreciate the phone calls we would have when you would call and say, I know you're not going to agree with me on this, but I want you to know why I feel the way I do. And it really helped. It was very helpful to me to have you here and to serve with you on the policy committee, I think was very useful. You represented our community. You should be proud of the way you represented the community and the voters who elected you. So I appreciate it. You've been an important part of our board. And as I'm sure we all do, you have great things to look forward to with Steve, and we wish you the best. And I hope you think of us every once in a while and let us know what's going on.
Well, I can never forget you guys. Yeah.
Yes.
Do I have a moment to respond?
Yes, we do.
So this board is a model of excellence in how it conducts its business, with everybody listening, civic discourse, just the way that we would like to see our country be, right? And hopefully it's going to be that way. I have really enjoyed working with each and every one of you. I just want to say, Ellen, as a board president, you're especially supportive of members, and me in particular, I can relate to that. Marilyn, you've just been a real champion for people of diverse opinions getting along together without having to assassinate each other's character. So I think that that is a direction to go to, because I came onto the board with a really major character assassination by people who didn't know me at all. And just the media has been just especially horrendous toward me. And then they resurrected all of that from 4 years ago to give me another little pinch and kick in the butt. So it's been rather difficult. So I thank you for the way you say I'm courageous. You guys know me. You know more about my character. And I thank you so much for putting it on the record. Two things have happened during this time is the redistricting. So I was elected by a large swath of people, 19,211 votes. Now we have small neighborhoods, which you can look and see who is Democrat and who's Republican. And there's lots and lots of Democrats in my TA6 and not very many Republicans. I was endorsed by the Republican Party. My opponent was endorsed by the Democrat Party. You can't say in this race that it's any longer a nonpartisan position, because it's been politicized. There really was nothing I could do to be reelected because the numbers were against me, not to mention what was being said in the media. So that, there you have it. But you guys, you are the ones that are the beacons in the harbor, bringing, you're going to be bringing the ship safely into harbor, into a safe place, by the example that you've set. Everybody here is just such a wonderful person. And I will really miss being with you and doing things as a voting body together. So I would say that I hope this is just farewell and not goodbye. I know we're going to meet at the celebration for Measure C accomplishments, the people that got, like, we got to see. Walt Millar. We got to see him. I got to meet him for the first time. And I said to him, I didn't really try to unseat you, Walt. I just was worried about the schools being locked down. I wanted to see if I could contribute anything as a longtime teacher to helping the schools get open again. But he said to me, I am so glad that you defeated me. I've had the best time of my life. And when I see you guys again, I'll probably be saying that to my opponent. I'm so glad you defeated me. I'm having the time of my life. And the second thing that happened during this time, other than that redistricting, which was way different, is that I got married. And so, yes, this is in a way a release for us to do things together in our new married life. I just want you to know that it's really not a defeat. It's a release to go on to other projects that he and I have together. And we also have a chance to move outside of like a 10-mile square area to a little larger field out there. And as you know, there's not that many properties available, so that'll be a good thing. So yeah, we have a lot of things to look forward to. And so anyway, I just really care about each and every one here, the administrative staff, Eric couldn't have been more, Dr. Prater couldn't have been a more loving, is the word, superintendent. And he's that way with everybody, even those who don't express love to him, that don't really know him. So it's been a wonderful experience. I've certainly learned a lot from each and every one of you and by doing this job. So thank you, and I'll see you soon.
Well, don't walk up quite yet, because we have Dr. Prater has flowers. We have some cookies. We would like to get to stand up and
maybe
send you off. So
maybe 10 minutes if you have some goodies back
we're
there.
Going to, it's 6:44. If we could get back at it by 5 till 7 or so,
great.
That would be great. one correspondence, and at the time the agenda was shared, there was published, no, there was no official correspondence received. So we will move on to 6.02, public comment. This is the time for members of the public who wish to address the board on items of within the purview of the school district, but not otherwise on the agenda, to speak to us this evening. Or if someone wants to speak to an item that is on the agenda but doesn't want to wait until that item comes before the board, you may speak now. You will have, there are yellow sheets at the back of the room. We would request that if you're in the room, you fill one out and bring it forward, and we will invite people to speak to us in the order in which they are received. Each speaker will have 3 minutes. We do have a strict timeline, timekeeping, that will appear on the screen as a countdown clock. We will go to people in the room first and then to Zoom. So if you wish to address us over Zoom, you will have an opportunity to do so. Mrs. Roger will read the names of people who have submitted request to address the board, and we will get started. Mrs. Roger.
Thank you. Let's see, this is in the order received. We'll begin with Jim Silva, followed by Donna Pulling. Okay, and you would like to be last? Okay. I'm sorry.
You know, we need to do these in the order they were received. So,
and that's the way that I found them when I came to the board table. So, Donna Pulling, are you prepared to go, or did you want Carolyn?
And each person has one opportunity to speak. So if you introduce the group, you will not have an opportunity to then speak again later.
Okay, Carolyn Krueger.
Followed by one after you.
Now we're all out of order. David Yowie.
I apologize. We tried to organize this so it would make sense to you.
Okay, your 3 minutes are starting.
Yes, my name is Carolyn Krueger. I'm a retired LAUSD teacher. I live in Morro Bay. I and 9 other citizens are here because we're concerned about SB 1277 that was signed into law on October 2nd. And SB 1277 deals with genocide education, and it identifies the California Teachers Collaborative on Holocaust and Genocide Education as the purveyor of professional development for California teachers. We're concerned about this collaborative, and in your package, on the top of the package is a flyer about our letter stating this concern. We have circulated a letter that is signed by 900 plus citizens so far and counting. And this has a QR code where you can access the letter and see the signatories. And it starts out, as educators, parents, students, and community stakeholders, we ask you not to contract for professional development with the California Teachers Collaborative for Holocaust and Genocide Education until its teacher training program, number one, includes scholars on Palestine, 2, expels the Anti-Defamation League and other organizations that conflate anti-Semitism with anti-Zionism, and 3, develops a transparent and accountable governance structure. Inside the package are alternatives in terms of teacher training. There's an explanation of the Teachers Collaborative, its constitution, what it stands for, and also a reading list. So we would like to open a conversation with you that will continue after tonight to help you find the best people to train teachers in this subject matter. We feel that this collaborative is biased. I'll just read one more bit. They work with the ADL, and the ADL's agenda is clear: deny Israel's genocide in Gaza and accuse those who argue otherwise of siding with terrorists. This is wrong. Our students need and deserve unbiased education about past and current genocides. We need education, not indoctrination. Thank you.
Thank you. David Yowie.
Good evening. My name is David Yo. I live in Morro Bay. I had nothing prepared. I would like to read something that a friend asked to be read. Her name is Vicki Carroll. She was a librarian at San Luis Obispo High School. She asked us to deliver her message since she could not be here. Here is her message. SLO High used to do an extensive unit on World War II, especially the genocide, with a focus on the resistance that helped the Jews. Half of our library history collection was books on World War II. We don't need any help from non-teachers to teach the curriculum that aligns with the state test. The teacher that taught this excellent unit was Joanne White. Since SLO High is on the quarter system, there are only about 12 weeks to focus on a subject. That is a lot to cover if you are going to prepare for the state test. So that I offer to the board. We are hopeful that we can have communication and prevent the school boards from being involved with a form of takeover that would indoctrinate our children instead of educate. There is a difference between history and myth. And a lot of what might be considered anti-Semitism is based on religion and based on myth and not true history. The Bible is not a reference for history. That last part is from myself, David Yo. So thank you very much for listening, and hopefully we can speak again at other times. We don't want to be radical. We're not looking to cause problems. We're just asking that our children not be forced into the mentality of the children of the Zionist Israel. And they're overlooking and not seeing a reality. And the people that are behind these bills are basically the people that are causing a genocide right now. And they're not honorable. So, and please don't misconstrue. There's a difference between Jewish people, Hebrews, Zionists. We have to be cautious. My time. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Jan Meslin.
It's right before me. I'm sorry.
We're all just.
We need to go in the order that we have our cards, please. Thank you.
I'm Jan Meslin. I live in Cayucos. And I just want to say that first, every single day, my heart breaks because this genocide in Palestine continues. And children are dying, especially. That breaks my heart the most. And the whole world just kind of seems to let it go on. So that's I just want to say that up front. The Anti-Defamation League lesson plans in its Echoes and Reflections unit reflect a bunch of concerns. And you can click on any lesson plan on how to talk about the Israel-Hamas conflict, and up pops the ADL Stay Informed page, which paints anti-Israel protesters as anti-Semitic. Additionally, the page links to an ADL college campus report card that awards higher grades to colleges that have passed student senate resolutions against boycotts of Israel. Not only that, but the ADL has a history and ongoing pattern of attacking social justice movements led by communities of color, queer people, immigrants, Muslims, Arabs, and other marginalized groups, while aligning itself with right-wing leaders and perpetrators of state violence. In addition to our concerns about the ADL and the lack of representation of Palestine scholars in the collaborative, we note that the state of California has outsourced genocide education to a collaborative with no accountability to the public. It's unclear how an organization becomes a member of the collaborative, how long the organization serves as a member, and whether the collaborative is subject to the Brown Act or the Public Records Act. And that is unacceptable. So after World War II, they said, never again, the Jews said, never again will there be a genocide, but there's a genocide going on right now. And so that's why so many millions of people around the world are really upset. And we don't want this to get into our schools. That we want it to be truth told in our education. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Donna.
Thank you. And I apologize for the insistence of the order of speaking, but the letter that we've been referring to was presented to the Santa Barbara School District as well. And I've highlighted certain sections of this letter that was signed by several hundred people. It's an open letter to California parents, educators, school boards, superintendents, county offices of education, and stakeholders. Recently, California Governor Newsom signed SB 1277, which establishes the problematic collaborative. That's the crucial point that we are trying to express here today, is that the collaborative is a composition of 14 organizations, over half of which are supporters of Israel, including the powerful Anti-Defamation League, ADL, that often works under the name of one of its thematic units, Echoes and Reflections. So they don't often identify themselves as the Anti-Defamation League. Rather, they use a pseudonym known as Echoes and Reflections, which is also the name of one of their units for teaching, reteaching history. Thank you for listening to us. We hope we get to come and have your cookies again sometime. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Silva.
My name is Jim Silva, and I'm a retired elementary school and secondary school teacher from Lompoc Unified. Okay, the Israel lobby wants us to teach more genocide education. We already adequately teach it as part of our social studies curriculum, so why? They say there's an uptick in anti-Semitism, but that's not true. They make up their own statistics, including any criticism of Israel and any anti-genocide protests, no matter how peaceful, even if they're put on by Jews, as anti-Semitic. But why would they lie about it and push this on us now? They're making an issue out of it, one, to distract us from the genocide that our government and Israel are committing now and over the past year, and also to continue the constant narrative of Israel as the victim. So we will continue to support the expansionist, racist, white European colonial settlement in the middle of Arab lands, including its removal and extermination of the natives, that's a common characteristic of all colonial settler societies, including ours. The World Court found enough evidence of genocide twice to recommend indictments of Israel's leaders, Netanyahu and Gallant. The International Criminal Court has requested arrest warrants for them for extermination, starvation, intentionally attacking civilian populations, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. That classroom discussion would be quite a learning experience, wouldn't it? But the curriculum the collaboration wants to foist on you and our kids won't include this genocide, the one that's happening now and the one that's most relevant to all of us. Because this genocide is our genocide, bought and paid for out of your pockets and mine with our tax money, pushed for by our bought and paid for politicians we voted in, and allowed and enabled by silence and lack of moral courage. Over 60% of all Americans want this genocide to end and want our government's support for it to stop. This collaboration curriculum won't prevent future Holocausts because its main purpose is to continue this one. It isn't mandated that you have to waste money and precious teacher time and staff time on this unfortunately harmful indoctrination. We have a moral duty to ourselves and to our kids to not teach propaganda supporting genocide. I urge you to bypass it. We can do better than this, and we already are.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else in the room who wishes to address the board? Okay, moving on to Zoom. All right. Okay, thank you very much. We will move on to our superintendent's updates. 7.01, business and budget update.
Yeah, just a quick note on the budget. We did receive our property tax information last week. And so it looks like we had an increase of about 4.2%. Which, though above our projection in our 10-year budget of about 1.1%, it did fall short of what we've received the last 2 years, which was over 6%, which was my hope in the looming deficits that we face and kind of catching up to, you know, one-time funds being expended, those types of things. So I'm going to be meeting with Dr. Prater, the executive cabinet team, tomorrow to look at what we can do now through the end of the school year to reduce this year's deficit, as well as begin the process of talking about budget reductions for the future, things we might need to do to bring forward to the board for your consideration. So we'll be working on that a lot over the next few weeks and coming months. There's a hope that right now in the state of California that the budget's looking better, taxes are coming in, there's the potential of one-time funds which could help. And we won't really know about that until January when the governor comes out. So in the meantime, it's time for us to start planning and working towards it and, you know, making sure that we have fiscal responsibility, moving forward. So that's what we'll start working on now, getting that information. And again, we'll be sharing a lot with the board and bringing you up to speed along that process.
Good evening, board. Lots of exciting things happening in our school district. Notably, this week, our elementary students are having parent-teacher conferences. So they're in school half days, and then teachers are conferencing and collaborating with families for student success. Today, we also had our third day with the Center for Educational Leadership presenter out of the University of Washington, Joanna Mickelson. Michelson, I'm sorry. And we talked about listening and centering student voice and what we want our student experience to be at our middle schools and high schools and what implications that would have for what kind of instruction and programming we have going on in our classrooms to ensure our students get that kind of experience. last Friday, what a great celebration at Los Ranchos for the Blue Ribbon celebration. Mr. McMillan and his parent team held a fantastic celebration ceremony for their recognition as a Blue Ribbon school. So hats off to all of them and congratulations for excellence at Los Ranchos Elementary. We held our third technology future ready and healthy technology use task force with parents and staff. Again, we're tackling issues like AI and how much screen time and what apps and digital programs our students are using. And I'll be providing an update to the board coming up in the new year following the conclusion of my work with the task force. I attended a couple San Luis Coastal Educational Foundation events, some strategic planning. We had an executive board meeting and then a board meeting today. Also, San Luis Obispo County Office of Education hosted our Educational Services Council meeting that keeps us abreast of all the upcoming changes related in laws and compliance and things. I attended site visits at some fantastic schools. Our board policy subcommittee met to prepare board policies for your review later tonight. And that's all I got for now.
See, if it's okay with the board, we have about 5 items tonight on Measure C that we're going to come up with. So I think I'll just wait until those items to give the board an update.
I think those begin now, Mr. Pinkerton.
They do. And actually comes up. So if it's okay, I'm going to stay here for the first one, which is
sure.
Basically just having the board open up a public hearing for a PG&E easement at Laguna Middle School. As part of the Measure C construction, we are upgrading the electrical service at the site. And so in order to do that, we need to bring in new lines from Los Osos Valley Road to the site. Which means that we do have to have an easement to get that work done.
So we are opening the public hearing on this matter. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to address the easement to PG&E? Anyone on Zoom? All right, we will close the public hearing. And next, Dr. Puccia, the reappointment of personnel commissioner. This also is a public hearing.
Good evening. Put it up here. Tonight, I'm here to present to the board and open up a public hearing related to the intention to reappoint a personnel commissioner. The San Luis Coastal Unified School District Personnel Commission is a 3-member body that one member of the commission appointed by the Board of Education and one point nominated by the classified employees of the district and the Board of Education. These 2 members in turn appoint a 3rd member. Ms. Irene Iwan has been the Board of Education appointee member of the Personnel Commission and has expressed an interest in continuing to serve as the commissioner for another term. As a registered voter residing in the attendance area of the district, she is eligible to serve as a personnel commissioner. The public hearing is an opportunity for the public, staff, and other interested parties to express their views on the appointment of Ms. Iwan to the Personnel Commission for the term beginning December 15th, 2024, and ending December 1st, 2027. Following the public hearing, the board may take action to appoint a new personnel commissioner.
Thank you. We will open this opens the public hearing on the intention to reappoint personnel commissioners. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to address the board on this? No one in the room, anyone online? All right, thank you. We will close the public hearing. Thank you, Dr. Puccia. All right, next we have some resolutions. And the first is 9.01, item 9.01, resolution 9.2425, Day of the Special Educator. Mrs. Gould.
Hello, good evening. My name is Janet Gould, and I'm your Executive Director of Student Support Services. And part of that gives me the honor of overseeing our special education department and working with a talented and dedicated group of professionals. And this evening, I am here to read resolution proclaiming December 2nd, 2024, is the San Luis Coastal Unified School District Day of the Special Educator. And I have Chris Unger joining me here this evening as a special educator himself. Right. So we are excited to be presenting this resolution this evening. So whereas December 2nd is National Special Education Day, because it is the date the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, IDEA, was signed into law in 1975, and
whereas special educators develop personalized goals for pupils tailored to each pupil's needs, and special educators are involved in behavioral, social, and academic development, and
whereas special educators work closely with parents to inform them of their child's progress and suggest techniques to promote learning at home, and work to build collaborative relationships based on trust, teamwork, shared accountability, and
whereas special educators help pupils overcome weaknesses by building upon their strengths and know that all children can learn, but not in the same way or at the same pace, and hold the highest expectations for success for their pupils to self-actualize and achieve their full potential, and
whereas special educators work to stay abreast of the latest laws governing special education to ensure that each pupil's individualized education program, or IEP, is a complete and beneficial document for the pupil and the pupil's parents and teachers, and
whereas special educators exhibit qualities of compassion, patience, and flexibility, and are the unsung heroes who pull all of the pieces together and make things clear for the pupil, and
whereas special educators include special day class teachers, resource specialists, speech and language pathologists, paraprofessionals, instructional assistants, behavioral specialist, occupational therapist, physical therapist, adaptive physical education teachers, deaf and hard of hearing specialist, visually impaired specialist, mobility specialist, autism specialist, program specialist, psychologists, and nurse who work in schools and serve pupils in special education.
Now therefore, be it resolved that the San Luis Obispo Coastal Board of Education
and the San Luis Coastal Superintendent of Schools hereby proclaim December 2nd, 2024 as the Day of the Special Educator,
adopted this 19th day of November 2024 by the Board of Education of the San Luis Coastal Unified School District. And I would like to make the motion to adopt resolution number 92425.
Thank you. We have
and I've also passed out postcards for Happy Day of the Special Educator to each of the board members to thank you for your support of our students with special needs. These cards come from our local San Luis Obispo SELPA, and all the artwork is done by our students.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak to this? We do have a motion on the table. Anyone online? All right, then we have a motion by Mr. Unger and a second by Mr. Buckman. Mr. Unger?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman?
Yeah.
Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. So that motion carries 6-0. Mrs. Hinton has gone for the evening. So we will move on to 9.02, a resolution about the easement we had.
PG&E easement, yeah. So as the board knows, with Measure C, we are basically, we're going through and redoing all of the HVAC, so heating, ventilation, adding air conditioning, and using electricity, using electrical systems instead of natural gas, which is more climate friendly, better for the environment, and also going to be great for our students and staff to have air conditioning and new heating systems. So with that, it's a big load that we're adding to our sites, right, in terms of electrical load. So you're going to see this. This is just the beginning of probably a few more PG&E easements that we'll have to do when we have to upgrade those services. But tonight, we're asking the board to approve this PG&E easement for the new system at Laguna Middle School.
Is there anyone from the public who wishes to address us about this? Anyone online? All right, then back to the board for any discussion or a motion. Mr. Banfield.
I move that we approve the resolution number 10-24-25. I'll second.
Right. We have a motion by Mr. Banfield, a second by Mrs. Roger. Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
Mr. Unger?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman? Yeah. Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Next is a resolution authorizing issuance and sale of 2022 general obligation bonds.
Yeah, so the next two resolutions kind of go together, and I'll explain. So as the board knows, the state just passed a new potential facility bond measure, hopefully, and it's going to go through. And we'll be looking to get matching funds for that, those types of things in the future, as well as there were many districts in the state of California that passed bond measures, which is fantastic. I think upwards to 67 to 70%, I think, in speaking with Mr. Isom, which is great for communities. That said, for us, we're always concerned about San Luis Coastal. And so in talking to our financial advisor, he thought it would be a good idea. And we were, I'd been talking to him about kind of the next sale and moving forward with our projects, that this may be a prime opportunity to get into the bond market to sell both our next series with Measure C, as well as the opportunity of reselling some of our Measure D bonds so that we can get a better interest rate, which will actually save taxpayers anywhere from $700,000 to $1 million in repayment over the life of those bonds. So the first one tonight is basically asking the board to approve a resolution. And so what we can package those together, which saves us on costs, both with financial advisors, as well as the bond sales themselves. So just a good opportunity to do both at the same time, as well as get in front of a lot of potential bond sales in the beginning of the new year. So again, all ways that we can help reduce and hopefully get a better rate in terms of repaying the bonds and save our taxpayers' dollars. So that's the point of why we're here today. So again, the first one tonight is really the next issuance of Measure C. Again, that we've gone over the phase budgets in terms of overall costs. And so this would just be the next influx of funds that would go into our accounts. And so tonight we're asking the board to approve that.
All right. Any discussion by the public? Anyone online? Okay, back to the board. And we appreciate all efforts to save our generous taxpayers' money.
Absolutely.
Mr. Clausen and Mr. Unger.
I was wondering if you could just walk through how many total issuances you think we'll do overall across the Measure C process, and if there's an optionality there or if it's pretty well set. And the reason I ask is it just seems like each issuance has kind of some fixed costs and fewer sounds less expensive.
Yeah, so we actually, I believe we had four planned with Measure D. And because of the growing, you know, nature of our property taxes and real estate values, we were able to actually to turn those into three. So right now, currently, we're looking at four. I mean, this is $349 million versus $177 million. But we're looking at probably about a four sales term. I would say about every 3 years is kind of what we've projected at this point. So this would be number two of four.
So is this second one aligned with when you were originally expecting it?
Yeah.
Or okay.
Yeah. I think, you know, based on, again, we've got a lot of work going. I just want to, I want to make sure we have enough in the bank, right, as we move into our new phase two projects we're going to ask you to approve tonight as well. Sure.
Mr. Unger, you had your light on, but.
Yeah, I was going to go ahead and make a motion to approve resolution 11-24-25.
Second.
All right, we have a motion by Mr. Unger, a second by Mr. Clausen. Mr. Unger?
Yes.
Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. We know how to pass a resolution. All right, next is 9.04, authorizing issuance and sale of 2024 general obligation resale bonds.
So there's something that's telling me that this is a misprint. It should say 2014, because that's when we passed Measure D. But again, our attorneys read it, went through. It does talk about 2014 series in the presentation, the materials that we received. So we're going to move forward knowing that this is a resale of our Series B 2014 Measure D bonds. Again, it's I believe it's about half of that, hopefully about 25 million of the 50 million. And we're expected to save taxpayers about, again, as I said, $700,000 to $1 million over the cost of the repayment of the issuance by doing these. And by putting them together, again, we're going to save on those financial costs of advisor and bond sales by doing them at the same time.
Yeah, that's a good question. Of course. Mr. Pinkerton, since I'm not really familiar with how this works, I'm wondering, is this resale of the bonds something that can be done multiple times?
So we've done
interest rates are favorable to
So each of the bond sales has a different rate, the right that when it was sold, we had a different rate that that it was accepted at. And so we've done this once before for Measure D.
Okay.
We've had one resale. You can only do a resale one time on that series of bonds. So this isn't something that you can just keep going, refinance your house. You can do this one time. So this resale would be the only time that that series that we could go back and try to resell those bonds at a better rate.
So when we had four rollouts or
three with Measure D.
Three with Measure D. Mm-hmm. So that leaves, if the board agrees to this tonight, then we still have one more opportunity on Measure D to reduce the cost of payback to the community. Okay, thank you.
Anyone from the public wishing to comment on this? And then I'll come back to the board. Anyone on Zoom? Okay, we're coming back to the board, Mr. Clausen.
Can you just explain the mechanics of how we save $700,000 at a 60-second level? I don't fully understand it.
Yeah, basically the market has to be in a place where they're able to sell bonds at a lower rate. So they're going to take these bonds that were sold at 3.5% interest rate, payback to maybe 3%. Right. So
interest rates have gone down.
Yes. In terms of they're more competitive right now in terms of the bonds. So again, for that series, I don't know exactly what the interest rate was for that. I mean, I can find out and let you know, but right now in the market, what they're saying is that we have the possibility of doing this. Right.
So basically the interest rate's lower. So we save money. Okay. Yeah.
It's refinancing your house at a lower interest rate, basically.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. Hey, Mr. Clausen. I mean, I'm sorry, Mr. Banfield.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm taking notes and, Mr. Banfield.
So, in my understanding, the resale of a bond is like the refinance of a mortgage.
I mean, not really, right? Because you're, because it's a debt, right? It's a debt that our citizens, our taxpayers who own property are paying back, right?
So we're going to
reauthorize them at a cheaper interest rate so that that payment ends up being cheaper over the course of the 20, 30 years that it's being repaid.
And this benefits the taxpayer.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, yeah. Good.
I think I went to the public on this. I want to make sure I'm getting myself confused. All right. Then we'll come back. We'll come back for a motion. Mr. Banfield.
I move that we approve resolution 12-24-25.
And I'll second.
Okay. We have a motion by Mr. Banfield and a second by Mrs. Roger. Mr. Banfield.
Yes.
Mr. Buckman.
Yes.
Mr. Claus. Mrs. Roger. Mr. Buckman. Mr. Clausen.
Do we need to clarify the 14 versus 24?
I think we're okay.
Okay, then yes. Okay.
Mr. Unger?
Yes.
I mean, yes.
So I will say Measure D for the taxpayers as well. It was initially 49 per 100,000. And because the growth in property values throughout, it's now at 39 per 100,000, Measure D resale for taxpayers. And I would assume that that's actually going to drop lower, that as our assessed property values have increased over the course of the last few years, that Measure D cost to our taxpayers would continue to drop, right? That's something that the county looks at on an annual basis. How much do they need to collect to pay those repayments, right, for the bonds? And so hopefully that'll continue to happen. And again, another way to save taxpayers money long-term. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next is 9.05, resolution number 132425, reaffirming safe school zone. Dr. Prater.
In December of 2016, this school board created a safe school zone resolution. And the purpose of that resolution was to acknowledge and be upfront about the importance that this board places on making sure that all students and their families feel safe coming to our schools, being in our schools, approaching us in our schools, where we become those places of safety. And in our society, in our communities that we serve, I think we've accomplished that really well. And I'm super proud to say that. So now fast forward to 2024, we've had a new presidential election, and the winning candidate has placed people in his cabinet team and made declarations about deporting students or families that are not legal citizens from America. And this resolution is to reaffirm to our community and to our families that we in San Luis Coastal are reaffirming that fundamental belief that our schools are safe places for all students and their families to be. And what I can tell you just from the brief time period since the presidential election, I've heard from numerous students and families that they are worried, anxious, and I'll just use the word frightened, that either their family or their relatives who live here and have lived here a long time will no longer be able to stay. And you can imagine how frightening that is. And so what this resolution does is it opens the door for us to then meet with the law enforcement like we did in 2016 and just make sure they understand that we are places of safety and we expect them to honor and support us in that effort. Okay. Now, Mrs. Sheffer, would you like to read this resolution?
I would.
Okay.
Thank you. Reaffirming San Luis Coastal Unified Schools as safe school zones. Whereas under the equal protection rights of the 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution, it is the right of every child, regardless of immigration status, to access a free public K-12 education. And whereas the Board of Education adopted resolution number 081617 on December 13, 2016, established San Luis Coastal Unified Schools District schools are safe zones, and whereas the district has a responsibility to ensure that all students who reside within its boundaries, regardless of immigration status, can safely access a free public K-12 education, and whereas federal immigration law enforcement activities on or around district property and transportation routes harmfully disrupt the learning environment to which all students, regardless of immigration status, are entitled. And whereas through its policies and practices, the district has made a commitment to a quality education for all students, which includes safe and stable learning environments. And whereas students and parents have expressed fear, anxiety, and confusion about the continued physical and emotional safety of all students and the right to access a free public K-12 education through district schools and programs. And whereas educational personnel are often the primary source of support and resources to assist students and student learning, which includes their emotional health. And whereas an environment of fear, anxiety, and confusion is not conducive to student achievement, student emotional well-being, the desire for families to participate in school activities, and the belief that district staff and administration will provide a safe environment for students and their families. And whereas the vision and mission of the Board of Education of San Luis Coastal Unified School District is to prepare each student for a life of purpose so they become courageous and creative thinkers who are college and career ready, skillful collaborators, and productive contributors to a diverse and rapidly evolving world through rigorous, relevant, and engaging experiences provided by caring, connected staff with support of the entire community. And whereas the board believes that our students' ability to achieve and thrive is negatively impacted by the fear of removal and actual removal of their family members during raids conducted by the Office of Immigration and Customs Enforcement that leave students without supervising adults to care for them. And whereas there is no written state or federal law that mandates that local districts assist the Office of Immigration and Customs Enforcement in the enforcement of immigration laws. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education of the San Luis Coastal Unified School District declares that every school district site is a safe place for its students and their families to seek help, assistance, information, and safety if faced with fear and anxiety about related immigration enforcement efforts. And be it further resolved that the U.S. Immigration Enforcement Office, ICE, state or local law enforcement agencies acting on behalf of ICE, or agents or officers for any federal, state, or local agency attempting to enforce federal immigration laws are to follow Board Policy 5145.13 to ensure the district meets its duty to provide all students, regardless of immigration status, access to a free public K-12 education. And be it further resolved, the district shall post this resolution at every school site and distribute it to district staff, students, and parents using usual means of communication, and that the resolution will be translated into all languages spoken by students at home. And be it further resolved that the superintendent shall ensure that all teachers, school administrators, and other staff will be trained on how to implement Board Policy 5145.13, and notification shall be distributed to families to fully inform them of their rights in the district. And be it finally resolved that any officer from the Office of Immigration and Customs Enforcement intending to enter any San Luis Coastal Unified School District property must first notify the superintendent of its intention with adequate notice so that the superintendent can take steps to provide for the emotional and physical safety of its students and staff. Passed and adopted this 19th day of November. Is there anyone from the public who would like to address the board on this? Yes.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Rosemary Wren, and I live in Shell Beach in the attendance area. I'm a former elementary school teacher, Cuesta College teacher, Cal Poly teacher. I work in teacher education, and I now work for the Commission on Teacher Credentialing. I think this is an incredibly important resolution for this board to pass. Our children right now are still recovering from the trauma of COVID, of being told they couldn't leave their houses or they would get sick, or that their parents might get sick, or they did get sick and they lost people. And then we expected them to come back to school and just act like everything was normal. And now we have children, some of our most marginalized students, facing some really scary, incredibly traumatic situations with what's going on. We can't shield them from hearing this. They're hearing it in their hallways. They're hearing it on their television sets. And so I think it's really important for the school to be a place where kids can come and know that they're safe. Kids can't learn when they're traumatized. I don't know if you've tried it. It's really hard if you've got something horrible going on in your life to be able to think. So I really am grateful to see that our board is standing up for kids in this way. And that we're supporting our communities, because it's more than just the kids, it's the entire community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else in the room? And anyone on Zoom? All right, then we'll come back. Anyone from the board have comments or questions? Mr. Buckman?
Yep. I have to say I haven't heard of another district that's being this bold and so brave, and I really want to thank the administration for bringing this forward. And I'm going to be voting in favor of this because it is so critical at this time.
I'm going to make the motion on this. I know I don't usually do this as president, but I'm going to make this motion this evening. But I would appreciate a second.
I'll second that.
Thank you. All right, there's a motion by me and a second by Mr. Banfield. Mr. Banfield.
Yes.
Mr. Buckman.
Yes.
Mr. Clausen.
Yes.
Mrs. Roger.
Yes.
Mr. Unger.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. All right. Now that the resolution portion of our program is complete, we will move on to our discussion action portion. 10.01 is reappointment of personnel commissioner. So, Dr. Puccia.
Good evening again. So as I shared earlier, the hope is the board would consider reappointing Ms. Irene Iwan to the Personnel Commission. She currently serves in that role, has been an outstanding personnel commissioner. And we're just thankful that she's willing to continue in this role and happy that the board would consider her as a continuation in that appointment.
Thank you. Is there anyone in the room who would like to address us on the reappointment? And anyone online? All right. And we're back to the board for discussion. Mrs. Roger?
If there's no board discussion, then I would move that the board reappoints Irene Iwan to the Personnel Commission and asks or directs Dr. Puccia to express our thanks for her service and her desire to continue to serve in that capacity.
Certainly.
And
I'll second that.
We have a motion by Mrs. Roger, a second by Mr. Banfield. Mrs. Roger.
Yes.
Mr. Banfield.
Yes.
Mr. Unger.
Yes.
Mr. Clausen.
Yes.
Mr. Buckman. And I'm a yes. All right. Thank you. And next we have a presentation for the single plans for student achievement.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity for us to present the SIPSAs for this year. SIPSAs, otherwise known as the Single Plan for Student Achievement, are something schools do every year and is a very important document that guides how schools do their business. So tonight we'll present a little about them, and then we have three examples and our administrators here. So we have Sophie Baywood, we have Kristen here from Los Osos Middle School, Ms. Contreras, and then Assistant Principal Ben Davis. Because the principal is driving back from San Jose and the girls won tonight. We found out they won. So Ben is here to present for Mr. Skull.
There we go. So tonight we are Coastal Strong and proud of that in our SIPSA representation as we look at a sampling of elementary, middle, and high school SIPSAs. I'm going to briefly dive into an explanation of what the SIPSA is, while then Mr. Neff will talk a little bit about what sites were doing to develop their SIPSAs. There we go. So really, our SIPSAs in a nutshell are really an opportunity for our school sites to engage with their educational partners in a continuous improvement process. And so this is a process through which they look at data, they create action steps that are aligned with the district goals that they feel are going to further ability to be able to achieve their desired outcomes for students. As you read through the SIPSAs, you probably noticed some repetition, and that is strategic. Our SIPSAs mirror our LCAP action steps. They are taken down to a site level, and then sites also have the opportunity to expand, and they have that autonomy to create some of their own action steps as well, depending upon their various funding sources, which are also listed in the SIPSAs, as well as who is responsible for each of those action items. So without further ado, we're going to have our Mr. Ness explain a little bit more about that process, and then we'll have Mrs. May explain a little bit about Baywood SIPSA.
There we go. So how does a principal develop a SIPSA? I think the key piece to take away would be they don't do it alone. It's very much a collaborative document working with the partners at that school. And so as Ms. Shepherd said, it aligns with the LCAP, right? And so sites provided a template that aligns with the LCAP, and principal gets that. And then the idea is then to work with their teams at their school. And so as a principal, this starts in early spring, where they would then start working with their instructional leadership team. If they're at a secondary level, their other site administration, counselors, support staff, that sort of thing. And then start also getting feedback from other partners at the school. And so you utilize school site council, your parent groups, your staff groups, your student survey data to look at that, to really look at, okay, what do we need to do at this school? What are our goals? How are we going to align budget to that? And what are those actual next steps? And so there's a timeline that is happening as this process goes all the way from basically spring till October, when they submitted for approval, which then comes usually in November, right? And so although during that time, that's this continual kind of engagement with their partners and conversations around what is the data showing us, what do we need to do, what is the feedback, the data both qualitative and quantitative, and then what do we want to do about it, what are those actual steps, what did we learn this year to do next year, to put that together kind of all in the SIPs. And again, I think the key piece is it's not a principal doing it alone, they're doing it with the partners at their school. And that involves students and staff and parents and community. And so there's a variety of mechanisms, whether it's PTA, school site council, boosters groups, staff surveys, that sort of thing, to get that input and put that kind of, basically that conversation into written form in the SIPSA. And so they do that all the way from the spring till they submit it to us in October, to then come to the board in November. And so with that, then I think we'll have our sites share their work. And so starting off with Baywood.
Hi there. Thanks for having us here tonight. At Baywood, we were really focused on social emotional learning and academic achievement for all students. We were really proud of our decrease in chronic absenteeism from last year and a lot of efforts put in there. What you see in our data is inclusive of our first third grade dual language immersion cohort, as well as our last English-only cohorts in fourth and fifth grade, also inclusive of our 16 special day class students in the upper grades as well. So we are really focused in this next year on continuing with our dual language development and acquisition, and then laser focused on really ensuring all of our second grade students are leaving second grade proficient in Spanish literacy, setting that foundation for introducing English in the third grade. We're also laser focused on our reclassification rate for our English learners, ensuring in dual language best practices for programmatic design, a third of the students reclassified by the end of third grade, a third reclassified by the end of fourth grade, the remaining third reclassified before they go to middle school and fifth grade, assuming those students have been with us since TK or kindergarten. We're also really looking at our students that we are reclassifying, ensuring that they're maintaining proficiency after their reclassification. Really proud of that in our data from last year. Our students who have been reclassified were on our district assessments, were showing a 100% proficiency rating on our district common assessments. We, as you might remember, we were a year ahead on our Spanish language arts and English language arts adoptions from our English only schools. So last year's focus was really on that, like, you know, literacy. And you can see that reflected in our decline in math scores. So this year we're really excited to pilot a STAR Universal Screener for Mathematics, giving us diagnostic data on what our students can and can't do in math, and then designing our MTSS systems and interventions, starting with our fifth grade students this year, really ensuring that they have that foundational fraction focus. So that's how we're responding to that data set. In closing, our overall focus in our SPSA this year is really on strengthening our MTSS models overall for student behavior, well-being, and academic achievement. And we're excited to move forward in this work and see gains for next year.
Where's the clicker? All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Heather Contreras, principal at Loam's. It's so nice to have you in our library. So our SIPSA, this is my first one doing, and it was, I have to say, Dan Nash has been great, and working with our team. One of the nice things I would say with the SIPSA is it is developed throughout the year and years of seeing, like, where's the need. It's not a document that just gets put together, and we do take it to other people, right, for approval, but it's always growing, and I want to just celebrate some of the things that we looked at and said, this is great, this is good work. Loam's received their second reaccreditation as a National Schools to Watch, and that is quite the process. It's similar to WASC. I think I've talked to you guys about it before. And so we are, through that, Mrs. Parsons, my assistant principal, and I are actually doing a Leaders to Watch throughout this year, which is really designated, which is really focused on the key components of how do we grow our school. It's collaborating with other schools. It's having an outside mentor as well, so that we can just make Loam's the best possible. And so with that, I wanted to highlight our reaccreditation. We continue our work on equity and inclusivity. Since 2021, I know I've talked about this before, since 2021, we have had a plan in place every year and have grown what we're doing with our students. Our students get 5 one-hour lessons throughout the year. All of our certificated staff do the lessons. They're all trained on the lessons so that we have a united front, and we're all working with our students the same way, and we have common agreements between our teachers so that we can create an environment that is safe for all students, and that really promotes student growth and also just having a great impact in our society here and then once they leave us as well. We've also, one of the highlights is that I want to highlight is we've created an intervention class for our students who are struggling. We have accelerated programs, we have advanced programs, and one of the areas that we saw a need for was where do we put students who are struggling, who are not yet receiving a 504 plan or an IEP, but they need some additional support. As Mrs. May talked about, the multi-tiered systems of support is huge, and it really helps give a student what's needed without being too restrictive. And so that's something that we continue. It is a pullout, so a student's not missing their elective. And we were able to add, with our scheduling, another teacher to support that work. They work very closely with our counselors. They work closely with the parents, with the students, and they're tracking and monitoring the growth of how is this program working. And so I don't have any data right now to give you, but when I come back and talk to you at the semester, I will. And I just want to really emphasize that the important work there. We also have our Counseling and Rich Center, which is another multi-tiered system of support that we're able to offer our students who may need a break, who may need a break from anything. And it's not a full day thing, but it offers a safe space similar to what the high schools are doing with the Wellness Center. And we're able to offer that because of our highly qualified CEP staff that's led by Mr. John Taylor. And so I wanted to highlight that. Some of our areas for growth, they remain. We see we have over 50% of our students involved in athletics, which is fantastic. And one of our goals is to increase the student connectedness, not only through athletics, but through drama, through clubs, up to 80%, especially our students who are our LCAP identified students. What we continue to see is a barrier, as you all know, between the achievement gaps between students who are in those LCAP identified groups. And then we also tend to see there's an alignment of students who are involved in extracurricular activities, involved in something, and how well they're doing in their academics and in their attendance. I see everyone shaking their heads. It's like, yep, it goes together. And so we are piloting this year through the support of our district. We are piloting our having staff members have clubs and then also provide some compensation for that. And we've seen an increase in clubs. We're also looking forward to being able to look at what students are going and where else can we add. Our clubs are student led. Right now we have a heavy metal club and the students go and find an advisor, and a lot of our staff are you know, willing to open up their rooms. And so it's really tailored around what's the student interest.
See him, the headbang.
The other area for growth is our chronically absent students. Last year, we were at 27%, and we are looking to lower that as well to 20%. That's our goal by the end of this year. And so my assistant principal, Mrs. Parsons, has been facilitating a lot of the attendance meetings with parents, connecting students to other resources. Our counseling services are very fruitful and allow students to find what they need. That one-on-one in-person connection is huge. This also connects to our push to expand our clubs as well. And we also are doing a lot of different incentives. We are not officially a PBIS school, but we do offer systems and rewards similar to that. One of the things that we do is we have a no tardy party for students who have had 5 or less tardies. Then we have a popcorn party, and the types of parties that we have increase throughout the year. And we're doing the same with attendance as well. Some of the key areas of our focus is providing our staff with professional learning time. And so we have our PLCs meeting regularly. Mrs. Parsons and I are going around and meeting with our department chairs, and also working in collaboration with LAMS. And there's a plan in place through our ISLA director as well to continue to grow that and align that. So we're very excited for that. We're also grateful for the resources to continue our equity committee work, and then also again just for the work that we have set out to get our kids connected. We do a lot of student surveying. Our senators are key in this. Their voices are heard loud and clear. And I will also say one of the things I'm very proud of, and that we will continue, is that our senators will start leading their own forums to hear more feedback, detailed specific feedback from their peers related to our Youth Truth Survey. And the next step throughout this year is going to be looking at we have our expectation matrix, our rules, if you will, but also starting to bring that to the students to take a look at and seeing how we can expand it or revise it with feeling like they have more of that buy-in. And so this is work that takes time and takes planning, and I'm happy to say that we are on that trajectory. I want to give one more shout out to us. I just recently was notified that Los Osos Middle School for the first time was named as a U.S. News Best Middle School. And so we are very excited. I'm going to be announcing that to our community on Friday. And I also want to shout out, I know, it's great. I messaged Carl Bloom and I said, have we received this before? Because it was the first time I've heard it. And he said, no. So we're very happy and excited. And I think it shows the good place that this school is. I also want to say we were recently published in a, a school climate study. And that was a couple years ago in the making. They came and participated or observed us at a superintendent student senate meeting. They did forums with parents, with teachers, with staff, with students as well. And they really had great things to say about the work that we're doing. And so I'm excited to share that. And we're just looking at more ways to grow. One other thing, we have a movie night for our community. If you're interested, we're going to be showing a screening of Elf at the Morro Bay Theater on December 16th. I'll send out a flyer to you. We'd love to have you. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Benjamin Davis, assistant principal at Morro Bay High School. Principal Scaldi really wanted to be here tonight, but he really also wanted to travel and support our girls who won the first playoff game, our CIF champion water polo team. So that's awesome. I can promise you all one thing with 100% certainty. I will use 50% less words than Scott tonight. So that's going to happen. The first thing I just want to highlight is our mission and vision. I mean, Morro Bay wants to be a safe, rigorous, relevant education experience for our students. It's important that our students are productive, healthy members of a diverse society. And so just saying that out loud, this really dovetails nicely with the equity work that we're doing, continuing this year, but really diving into. And it's been beneficial for our staff. It's been beneficial for our community. And I just want to appreciate all the leadership you had on bringing that to us. So thank you. Real quick. Celebrations from 23-24, we successfully completed a WASC, which is great. We are on a 6-year accreditation with a 1-day visit. That work of analyzing our data and getting all the feedback from our teachers and our staff helped shape this SIPSA dramatically. And so a lot of the goals and the action items were really pulled from that as well. The other thing that Scott would be very upset if I just didn't hammer home is that our California school dashboard came out and our data was very, very good. He likes to say we were the best in 7 counties. And what he's saying by that is just we only had blues and greens, which means we really just didn't drop the ball with any subgroup. It was very positive. And so hopefully we're going to continue that in the future. The other thing that Scott's extremely passionate about and our whole team is really is just the increase in number of students and number of AP tests that are happening on campus. And so over the last 2 years, we're 150% increase. And that's not just kids taking more tests, but we're at the highest percentage of passing, 82% passage rate for AP tests. And so more students are accessing advanced curriculum and more students are showing success in advanced curriculum. Really, really excited about that. And then we successfully opened our ROC, the Wellness Center. So we're providing every student with really amazing opportunities to find the resources they need so they can come to school and they can feel safe at school no matter what's going on in their personal lives. And so we're really proud of that, and we're seeing data that's dramatic. So again, it's just, again, we're very appreciative of what's being brought to us and brought to our campus. Our areas of focus, CTE, making sure that our students have opportunities outside the classroom. So that's field trips, that's internships, that's speakers coming in. We think it's so important that those pathways live. They're not just in theory, but they're actual things that the students experience. And so they can have those opportunities outside the classroom and then continue on in their life. Really having a very strong implementation of tier 1 interventions that goes along with the MTSS model. And just so you're seeing similar things that are happening all throughout the school that you can see in every single classroom, we want to focus on those tier 1 supports. And then just making sure that we are very diligent in having as many students as possible meet the A through G CSU UC requirements. We want to see those numbers go up every single year. With a goal of 80%. So our highlights, the key action, just setting really clear expectations with our CTE teachers of what a 3-year plan, outreach plan will be for them, the number of field trips, the job shadows, the internship, the guest speakers, and identifying an internship coordinator on our staff so they can explore, develop, and make sure that that's happening in every single pathway. Refine and design tier 1 interventions, so that we can see those things in every single classroom. Currently, we're working on two, just making sure that we're being really deliberate around peer-to-peer interactions in every single classroom, as well as something that has been a topic. It's just technology in the classrooms. And so making sure that cell phones are not part of the classroom unless they're intended to be part of the classroom by the teacher and by Principal Scaldi. And so we are seeing that as just cell phones are put away, and it's increasing students' engagement with the curriculum, which is great. And then the other one is by June 2025, we want to reduce the number of chronically absent students by 5%. We feel strongly that if students feel supported, understand the relationships they have on campus, they will come to school more. We know that's true. And so we want to focus on tier one practices, and we want to build relationships with students. And we're doing that in a few very targeted approaches. We have a tracker that we have all the staff members participate in, and it has every student on there. And the expectation is, do you know this child beyond just being in your classroom? Do you know that they have a pet with their dog's name in? Do you know what's going on with their siblings? What are their favorite things to do non-academic? Are they involved in sports? And so staff look at this list of the entire, of every single student, and they commit, yeah, I know this kid. I know this kid here, and I know this kid here. And we sign up, and then we look, who do we not know? Who doesn't have any staff names next to them? Then the challenge is, let's make sure that every single one of those kids has a staff member named. And so coming into semester two, our ILT sat down and said, hey, we got these tier one interventions that we want to do around peer-to-peer communication. Let's use that relationship tracker, and let's pick the kids who people don't know, and let's set goals. I want to hear that child's voice in class. That's important to me. That's important to their peers. And so making sure that those kids feel the love, whether they know it, that we're targeting them or not, we think is going to have an important impact on their attendance. And so anyways, we're excited. And Scott will, again, we'll be back soon to address you all. Thank you.
I'd like to, did you have more to add?
Okay.
I wanted to go to the public first and see if anyone has any questions or comments. See no one back, and no one online. We're back to the board, Mr. Unger.
Yeah, you kind of teased me, Stephanie, on Friday, and when we were at the Blue Ribbon thing, and Stephanie said, have a great weekend. You'll be reading the SIPSIS for the rest of the weekend. And you were right. But I think they're really interesting. And I think you really get a snapshot. You can get an interesting snapshot of a school by going through them. And there are a couple of things that really stood out to me. First, I really appreciate how you took the LCAP, and brought it into the SIPSIS, and along with that, our board priorities. So specifically closing the achievement gap, our looking at social emotional learning, and our look at data. Lots of talk about data, lots of talk about collaboration, really moving forward on student achievement. I think also, and I think most of you mentioned it, what are we doing about student connections and student connections to the schools? I think every single one of the SIPs has talked about that. And really, how does that relate to absenteeism, right? And student behavior and things like that. So I was pretty stoked about that. I'm just a couple of things. Kristen, how has your English language arts implementation been going? Because you guys were really the first. So you started it last year, and then I know it's going on in UN Pacheco. How has it been going, given that it was introduced last year and where you're seeing it this year?
Yeah, I would say that the biggest thing that we've seen, we've been doing some admin learning walks. And so I had the pleasure of hosting some of my colleagues at Baywood, where we walked around and looked at the new curriculum. And some of that feedback was, wow, it's so great to see where we might be in year two, because we only know what we know from our perspective, right? I'd say the biggest difference for us this year is that we, as more tools are being developed, as the English-only schools are coming on board with a similar curriculum, is we are in a better place to access a lot more of the supplemental materials that are provided, songs and chants, extra, some of the other resources, the Reader's Theater, things like that. So once you get
the groove of your tier one instruction, you can start bringing in those other pieces. So I think that's the biggest difference I've seen.
Thanks. I was interested in that. Also, what's Metametrics and why is Metametrics important?
So Metametrics is kind of the behind the scenes calculation that happens with our Renaissance learning assessment. So are you looking specifically at
data? Well, I thought that was data that was referred to in every elementary school. And I looked it up and it looked like it had to do with reading Lexiles.
It does,
but,
yes.
But you know, I'm just curious how that relates to like the CAP, you know, the state testing scores and some things like that. And just how this relates to the data collection and instruction.
Yeah, it's a great question. And I don't think we can pull the reports yet, but STAR specifically does have some projections that allow us to take a look at a correlation between how our students are achieving and the trajectory that they're taking and whether or not we can predict if they're going to achieve proficiency on CASP.
Okay. And I think the other thing that was just apparent, of course, is that the achievement gap, you know, unfortunately lives and breathes, and that we're working our hardest to close it. I see us closing it, but it's a long, slow process. And I think we've been focusing a lot on our English language arts, which we absolutely need to, but I'm seeing that math really seems to be an area that we're going to need to focus our efforts on, as well as English language arts and the social emotional learning and the CASP science too. The CASP science, I was kind of surprised that I think no school achieved more than about 50 or 53% mm-hmm. proficiency. And that strikes me as being a clearly important area for us too. So those are just some things that I noticed about it. But again, phenomenal documents, a lot of work you guys put into it. And I think it really says a lot about what you're knowing about your students and what you're seeing your students need in order to be successful.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. So the SIPSA is a really impressive process, and the fact that we create action plans based on metrics at a detailed level for each site is really impressive. And I have two questions about it. One is it's also a bit overwhelming. Remember the first time I read the SIPSA, I said, wow, that is a lot of good stuff, but a lot of stuff. So I guess my first question is, how is the SIPSA absorbed by the sites and by the community and by the staff? Is it something that, you know, we're able to put in enough bite-sized actions by site that it works? I mean, I doubt that many people just sit down and read the whole SIPSA and go, okay, I got it. So like this question one is, how do we make it actionable and not overwhelming? And then my second question is, it seems like we have a lot of really strong new perspectives between Stephanie, Dan, Lisa, coming from new districts and new leaders at many of our sites. And how has your perspective from other school districts affected how we're approaching the SIPSA? And are there things we're changing because of external perspective? So I guess as far as to be concise, I'd say two questions. How do we make this actionable and not overwhelming? And then what have we learned from your guys' other perspectives?
And I think I'll maybe ask one of the principals to speak to how they specifically infuse this into their broader community and at their sites. But I feel like I can answer both questions in a somewhat succinct manner. We've really, because it is so closely aligned to the LCAP and you see so many action steps that are a direct mirror, I think that is the methodology that we're taking. Because we've reduced the amount of LCAP action steps, and we've tried to be incredibly strategic with what it is that we're honing in on based upon all of the feedback from our educational partners, I think that the trickle down to the SIPSAs is now, hopefully it felt like a little bit lighter document if you printed it out and actually read through it, because it was many fewer pages this year. The action steps were condensed, just as the LCAP action steps were condensed. And then if one of you wants to speak to a little bit about how you infuse it.
I agree with the overwhelming part, right, that as a first year. And like I said, Dan came and was like, okay, chunk it like this. And really, as an educator, you look at a school and you look at like their main components at any school that you go to, right? You're looking for kids to achieve academically. You're looking for kids to feel safe and to feel connected at school. And you're looking for kids to show up. And then also you're looking for there to be a partnership with their families. And so when I know when we were looking at it, when I was first digging into it, it's like, what are we doing already that is addressing, that's hitting these components? What have we heard from students previously? Every year, we, my student senators, write goals for our teachers that they present to our teachers, that they share with their classmates, that are based on the Youth True Survey. And so we really just aligned it to that, because everything's connected with your goals, with the goals that we receive as well from the district, and that are all aligned with academics, connection, attendance, and community. And so I think when you just kind of break it down like that, then we're looking at what are we doing that's hitting these things? And if we want to bring something new in, then where is it going to hit? Does it have value? Which everything has value. And so I know for Loams, one of our things is growing our parent community. And so we're looking at, we've been adding different events for the families to come and be part of. We had over 200 families on the lawn a couple Fridays ago for another lunch on the lawn. And we're looking to bring more families in to our Elf movie, you know, just to gather and be together. We had a dance last week. We're bringing kids in. We're wanting, we're encouraging students who may not typically go to go. And then we're also looking at the academic piece. Students say, you know, we want more, they'll use the word rigor because that's in the Youth Truth Survey. But it's really looking at like, how are we teaching and engaging the students? And then how are they really stretching their minds to think critically? And so that's the way that we do it. And everything that we do here was kind of just like a brain dump, and then figuring out where to place it. And then what do we want to refine? What do we need to refine?
The key part is alignment, you know, having been in the SIPSA game since I think 2011 now, and seeing, you know, for those who have been like, it's, we've gone, all districts have gone through different iterations, right? But the key is really aligning to district goals and LCAP, right? And then it just goes down from there, and then it's all vertically aligned. And so then as a principal, if you know what the district goals are, which hopefully you do, right, then your SIPSA goals are automatically aligned to that. And then as a district, it's a branding piece, right? If we're all saying these are our three goals, student achievement group with subgroups, culture of care, then you develop like an elevator pitch, right? And so then it's just communicating. It's easier as a principal if it's all aligned to then messaging to your educational partners. And it's a sort of the same, let's say, elevator pitch you would give, or that story, you may tailor it, you know, in terms of how do you take this big document, you tailor it to your audience. And what are, you know, different audience members kind of would need to know or be interested in different components versus just giving them the whole thing, right?
You don't just give them the SIPSA.
No, you can, but I don't know how, you know, it's hard, right? There's a lot of things that go on at schools.
Sure. And similar to the LCAP, SIPSA, the acronym in and of itself, I don't think has much connection with our community. And so what you'll see consistently in our school newsletters is, typically, our principals are alternating between providing updates on attendance, academics, as well as what's happening in like the world of counseling and SEL. And so I think that is a very specific, but probably a visible example that you all see as you glance through the newsletters each week of how we infuse that and keep the community informed. So although it doesn't have the label of SIPSA, it is all work that's relevant and tied to the school, the single plans for student achievement.
Everything is messaged through those three goal areas, right?
Yeah, and I just want to add, because it was a really insightful question, and I thought you answered it really well. The piece that I see, if I have a vision for this, utilizing to further simplify and internalize success metrics for those areas, using Parsec to create custom dashboards so that you, the board, can pull up the things that you might have questions about at each of the school sites. So you might, in the olden days, you'd pull up a giant document, an LCAP document that it's hard to read. You might pull up a giant document, if you're really brave, the SIP says, right? And start finding out what you're looking for. But the evolution of this, I envision becoming easily accessible through a customizable doc template on using Parsec, which is our new engine for data. So now you have the metrics, you have the accountability measure, but just as importantly, you have empowered your principals and your teachers to understand it as well. And and they're working with it all the time, as opposed to the old binders on the shelf that you check off when you finish it and they get everyone signed off on it and it goes back up on the shelf. So where we're going, that I'm most excited about, is integrating all these things in a simplified template dashboard that is dynamic. So it evolves as the data changes. So you have the pulse of how every school is doing in those critical areas. So that's where we're heading.
Thank you. I just want to add, when I was looking at the SIPSAs over the weekend, I realized that I have been spent about 16 years, I can't believe it, as a parent, as a school site council, the GATE Advisory Committee, which Marilyn and I were on together, which no longer exists, and as PTA president, going over SIPSAs. And then I've been on the school board for almost about 16 years now. So I feel like I have this perspective that I hadn't really considered at all until looking at them this time. And the evolution, the refinement, the data that, you know, just wasn't available to us that all those years ago, the what we're seeing in goal setting and in the areas that we need to really devote some energy, some finance, some resources, financial and otherwise resources to, you know, it's just been an interesting perspective over all these years as a parent and various community member, and then now as a trustee. So I am aware of the work that goes into this. I'm aware of the importance and the need to let your school pop, the school community know that this exists, that we take a look at all this information, that we take a look at the data, we take a look at the individual site and its culture and its needs and its celebrations, and try and synthesize all that into an ongoing document. So thank you for that. This is an action item. Mr. Unger, I see your light.
Yeah, and I'll make the motion, but I also wanted to say, kind of along what you're talking about, Ellen, I think what we've seen is an evolution of the SIPSAs, going from these just sort of disparate documents where every school did kind of its own thing, to more standardization that we're seeing now, focusing on our LCAP, and then with the individual site plans, you know, so going through them and saying, oh, this school site's doing this, this school site's doing this, but in general, these are the areas that we want to, that we need to look at. So I've seen that as an evolution as mm-hmm. well. And I think we'll probably see more of that with our LCAP going along, but that's been really, really super helpful too. So I've made the motion to approve the single plans.
I'll second it.
We have a motion by Mr. Unger and a second by Mr. Banfield. Mr. Unger?
Yes.
Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman? Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
I am a yes. All right. Thank you. Thanks for all your work.
No, I just wanted to say thank you. The three of you coming to present really brings a perspective to it that is really, really important. So you guys are very busy. So thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to look at
your
policies.
Bye. Oh, come on. All right, next is 10.03, approval of nomination for county committee for school district organization. Dr. Prater, is that you? 10.03.
Yes.
You need some PB at this,
right? Yeah, I apologize. So the county, San Luis Obispo County, has a committee on school district organization, which essentially includes the Lucia Mar, San Luis Coastal, representatives from Lucia Mar and San Luis Coastal. Historically, we've had members of our community, we've had retired trustees, we've had former employees that retired. And in this case, they're looking for a representative to sit on this particular committee. This committee used to be more important to us prior to us negotiating the deal with Cayucas and Coast for the exchange of resources. And now it's still important. I'm not sure. What I want to say is it usually meets once, maybe twice a year. And I'm not sure what they really talk about anymore, but it's a committee that's formed, and it has an agenda, and they meet when they have issues that arise related to things that impact the various districts. So in this case, Dr. Brescher reached out to me and asked if they were struggling to find a representative, and asked if Ellen Sheffer would consider being on this committee. So I remember calling Ellen saying, how do you feel about being on this committee? And she said, well, what is the committee? And I had to remind her, and I think we talked about it. So she reluctantly said yes, that she would serve on this committee. And so what you have before you is the recommended action to nominate Ellen Sheffer, to approve Ellen's nomination for this particular representative committee. So she did say to me that if anyone else would want to do it, she'd gladly hand it over. So absent that, I am asking for the board to approve this nomination.
I will say that once, several years ago, apparently I was on this committee and didn't even know it, and received a call from Dr. Brush's office, and this was a long time ago, saying they were meeting, and I argued with then Val Karaski, it was when Julian Crocker was superintendent, saying, I'm not on this committee. I don't even know what you're talking about. And apparently I was. I've never attended a meeting. I don't really, but apparently they need somebody, and time was running down. So here I am. If anyone else would like to do it, that's fine. I have no idea what we'll be doing. Otherwise, I'm happy to help. Mr. Clausen.
I said that was a compelling speech, so I would move that you be nominated unless someone else has discussion.
I'd like to second Ellen's reluctant willingness to serve on this committee.
Okay. We need to go to the public and see if anyone has a strong opposition to this.
Maybe someone from the public wants to do
it. Yeah.
Would you like?
I was going to say, this committee is important when it's important.
Yes, and that's true.
And when it's not, it just kind of,
yeah. When it's been important, we have very carefully selected someone who could really serve us well with the particular issue we're looking at. It is a 1-year thing, I think, isn't it? It's not lifetime or anything.
Free committee for life.
Okay. All right. Anyone else? All right. There's a motion by Mr. Clausen and a second by Mrs. Roger. Mr. Clausen.
Yes.
Mrs. Roger.
Yes. And I hope they give you a lanyard.
I need another one. Mr. Banfield.
Yes.
Mr. Buckland. Yes. Mr. Unger.
Yes.
Okay, I'll say yes. All right. Thank you. 10.04 is Measure C, an approval of architect contract amendment.
Yeah, so bringing forward three architect contracts potentially tonight for the board, and this is to begin the phase two work, which is basically kind of in a nutshell, I'll give each three schools. So for Los Ranchos, it's all of the, basically all the classroom buildings, adding HVAC, interiors, exteriors, as well as restrooms. For Bishop's Peak, it's the two main classroom buildings, So we're kind of doing the kindergarten wing now. We're putting in the new modulars. We've already done the multipurpose room, the office. So this is the last two classroom wings for that phase. And then for CL Smith, it's basically right now we're doing the kindergarten classroom wing. We did the modulars along the side there. So this is all of the permanent classrooms on the campus, not the portables, but the rest of the permanent classrooms, the interiors. Of course, with Measure D, we did already do the main office building on that campus. So those are the three contracts. We feel really good about moving forward with KBZ and RRM. They've done a great job with phase one on those. And so we bring these tonight because we're seeing DSA being really slow. So kind of pushing, especially from the structural team. I talking to the architects, I don't know that they have enough people working in those departments, but it's just lagging. Getting feedback, we input our documents, they get kicked back. We have to wait till they come back. And so it's been a little slow on some of the phase one. So we're still waiting on Pacheco. We're waiting on PEB. We're waiting on Los Ranchos. And so all within the next couple of months, I would say, PEB first. But the others, it's kind of out of our control. We just have to wait for DSA for those actual approvable documents to go forward.
Is it a backlog? Is that what's going on?
Yeah, I don't know if it's a backlog. I assume so. And talking to the architects, right? It's also, depending on who the person is that's doing your approvals, it can take a lot more work, right, in terms of what they're requesting from you, the documentation. The architects try to get it back, but you just have to wait. You just wait until those projects are done. So, again, this is kind of a – I will tell you that at Bishop's Peak – we did kind of a comparison of modernizing the two remaining classroom wings versus just building new. And the prices, it's kind of the same. So I think we're just going to most likely, we're meeting with Diana Jones tomorrow. But I think we'll probably just knock down the two buildings and start over on that campus. Because it's the sewer infrastructure. We started in the kindergarten building there now. Once we got into the building, we're going through it now. The sewer is bad. So, again, all those things underneath. So by the time you go through all that process and paint, then you probably should have just started over to begin with. So, and by new buildings, new building construction is going to be a lot easier to get through DSA than going through the modernization aspect of it too. So there's kind of a win-win there. From an architect fee standpoint, it's cheaper if we do new construction versus modernization. So there's just some other things that really, when we looked at the overall cost, it wasn't that much more to just really go new on those two, kind of the two wings that are there. They need a lot of work, the two main interior classroom wings of BP.
Okay, anyone from the public with comments or questions about this? All right, coming back to the board, any other questions or comments? Otherwise, we do need to approve this. This is Roger.
I would like to clarify. So what we're approving here tonight are the architectural agreements specifically for Bishop's Peak. This is for drawing up new construction documents.
For the two interior classroom buildings.
How do we propose to schedule?
So that's why we're meeting with Diana Jones in the morning. But I honestly think that they will have enough classrooms with the temporary classrooms we brought in. Once we get the new kindergarten wing up, once we get the new modulars in, they still have the portables in the back. That school is relatively small. We may be able to do both classroom wings at the same time. And I literally have a meeting tomorrow at 8 o'clock with Diana Jones to see if we can pull that off. That would be the cheapest, most inexpensive way to do it all at once. So we'll see if we're able to pull that off, you know, in terms of the classroom.
Okay, I'd be interested just sometime to sit with you and see what the difference was between the
modernization. Absolutely, yeah. We have RM with the whole
cost now. New construction is always easier and cheaper than remodel work.
I'll share it with you. Yeah.
Okay. And with regard to DSA, I just throw out one other possible reason things are moving so slow is because the state deficit. I know this because my daughter's looking to get back on with state parks, that because of the deficit, they don't have a hiring freeze on, but they are moving very slowly on hiring and replacing. So I think at DSA, there maybe they are have fewer plan checkers and a lot of work.
They said it was a lack of architects working on the projects.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Right. This is an action item, 10.04. So I would appreciate a motion and a second, please.
I'll move approval of item 10.04, approval of architect contract amendments for phase two modernization project at Bishop's Peak, DL Smith, and Los Ranchos.
Second.
We have a motion by Mrs. Roger, a second by Mr. Clausen. Mrs. Roger.
Yes.
Mr. Clausen.
Yes.
Mr. Buckman.
Yes.
Mr. Unger.
Yes.
Mr. Banfield.
Yes.
Yes. All right. 10.05.
So yeah, Harris Construction is the leaseback contractor for Hawthorne Elementary School, and that's what this we got our GMP back. I'd say kind of the two things kind of came out with this project. One, as we went through phase one construction, we decided to go ahead like we did at Monarch Grove and go ahead and do the interiors at the same time. You're going to have teachers move out of classrooms. We might as well just do that work. I mean, realistically, were we able to really go in and change roofs and put in HVAC while a class is going on? Probably not, right? So there was a cost associated with expanding this to 20 months instead of the 8 months of just doing the outside construction. So that said, it's going to be a much better process in terms of for staff. You move out once, you move back in after the work's completed, and we go through. So so this basically is the entire main classroom building. So redoing the entire thing, top to bottom, right? Interiors, exteriors, new heating, ventilation, air conditioning, all of the concrete around, which was probably, again, the bid that came back higher than anticipated was the concrete cost. It was really expensive. But there's a lot of concrete work being done. So literally all of the concrete around that main building, all of the concrete and really the ramps that go on the front of the school, because we're putting a whole new front to have that DSA, not DSA, but disability ADA access. You know, right now they had the gate. You couldn't even get into the office building, right, if you were in a wheelchair. So all of that's being redone to make the office ADA, capable and accessible. And so all of that work down by the multi-purpose room, a lot of concrete work there as well, right? So the ramp that goes down, the extra access that the site had wanted. This also includes finishing the main office, library, and the classrooms there, as well as the kindergarten, new kindergarten classrooms underneath. So it's really the entire campus other than really the multi-purpose room. That's phase two. So that's why it's more a little bit more expensive than phase one initially. But again, when you put phase two together with phase one, it's still coming in about $1.5 million over what we anticipated in terms of overall, bids. And again, but a lot of that was, again, we talked about the infrastructure upgrades tied to it in terms of cost there. And then in particular, the concrete bid was high. Not high so much in the cost per square foot, but just the amount of work and the cost associated with doing all of that work.
Didn't we say something about the fact that concrete work was kind of almost a surprise, like it was mandated or?
Yeah, some of it.
Expecting that, all of that.
Again, some of the sites you'll see, you look and it's good looking concrete, right? But if the slope is off just a little bit, it doesn't match, then they have to go through and make it accessible.
Is that for seismic concerns as well, or
not really seismic? Not with concrete, right? So a lot of it's that ADA accessibility. Also, we're redoing all the doorways, so all the entrances, all of the classrooms, so all of that has to be redone. So just as they're doing that work around the building, they're doing it all, right? So in this case, it's going to be done in about four phases. So the first phase is the TKK, which is what we've been doing at every single site, right? Getting those prepared, getting those classrooms ready. And so they'll start there, and then they basically move through the building they've worked with the principal, with the schools, with the teachers, kind of, okay, how can we map this out in a way that the teachers move out one time and then they move back into their wing. So we kind of have this end of the day, where do we want all the staff to be? And kind of planning that out as we make these changes, as we do the construction. So it's going to be loud. It's going to be rough, right? We try to warn them as through it, but this is one where, again, it's like right on them. It's a relatively small campus. So we'll do what we can to mitigate that, of course, throughout. But it's we're excited to finally get this going. We need the front of that school put back together. It's great that we can get this work started. We anticipate to start, I think, the week after or the day after Thanksgiving break. Paris Construction will begin the work if the board approves the GMP tonight.
All right. We'll go to the public about this item. All right. Seeing none, we will come back to the board for a vote, for a motion and a vote.
I move to approve amendment number 2. For the lease-back sublease.
I'll second. Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman? Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
Mr. Unger?
Yep.
Yes. All right, we will.
Thank you.
Oh, next we have some policies.
Yes, good evening, board. The first board policy for our first reading I'm bringing before you tonight is regarding community relations. It's board policy 1230. And it essentially establishes that anyone proposing a school-connected organization request must get board authorization. And furthermore, it clarifies that that school-connected organization must have its own bylaws, but also operate in accordance with the laws, as well as our board policies and administrative regulations already in place.
This is a first reading. Is there anyone from the public who wants to talk to us about this? Any comments from the board, Mr. Clausen?
So I just wanted to clarify, does this mean if you wanted to create one of these organizations today, you do not need board approval and this changes it so you do need board approval?
It did require, before I speak to that, I would have to go back and do research. So I'll have to go back and look at the former one. I don't believe if we pull it, let me pull it up.
Maybe let me ask a different question. I'm just trying to get context. What's an example of a school-connected organization? Do we have any, or do we have lots of them? Or
we do have lots of them. They are parent organizations, booster clubs, all of those groups that support our schools. Our
so
schools.
If someone wanted to create a
new competing
club,
yes,
low high, they would need board approval.
Yes, that's correct.
Does that answer your question, or would you like it could be further addressed perhaps
if I'm interpreting it correctly, we're just implementing the recommended.
That's accurate. This is recommended change by Gamut and CSBA. You'll note that on the redlined version, that those are the changes near the bottom of the first page. Gamut is essentially recommending that we take out the section, for example, in the last paragraph at the bottom about its impact of fundraising on overall school and district. They may consult with principals, and essentially they just created one overarching statement that you must get board approval and you must follow the bylaws that you create and board policies already in place. There is an added section down below on the top of the second page where it says a school-connected organization shall obtain the written approval of the superintendent or designee prior to soliciting funds upon the representation that the funds will be used wholly or in part for the benefit of the district school or the schools at that district. So it does limit individuals' ability to go out and say, I'm fundraising for a LOSO school trip to Washington, D.C., if we have not already, as a board and school, approved a field trip for LOSO to take for a purpose.
I'm trying to get context on whether we're going to get a bunch of new requests that we didn't get in the past, or if this is just clarifying things that already happened. Because I maybe it's a new board member question that I don't understand. So I don't have any issue with it. I'm just trying to understand if it changes anything materially from how we used to do it.
I can't think of any outside organization or school connected organization that we've ever had brought before the board for approval. But then I'm trying to think, are there any new organizations that during my time that have been established?
Well, I'd imagine examples would be my kids on sport team X, right, and we're going to do parents of the water polo team or parents of water polo team booster. Like, mm-hmm. Are we now that all those have to come here? I mean,
no, that's interesting.
May not be worth anyway.
Or would they fall under the already established athletic boosters or something like that? You know,
I would have to look into the processes at San Luis Coastal, but usually what I understood from Mr. O'Connor last school year was that all of those groups were already under one umbrella of the 503C of it's black and gold. Is that correct? The athletic booster slow tab? Yes, that's it. The athletic booster. And that although individual teams may solicit for funds, it is all with in that one umbrella, and then the funds are distributed. But I can certainly provide the board with more information with the aid of Mr. Neff and Mrs. Shepherd, the list of all of our school groups, if that would be
useful. Yeah, it's probably more I'm just trying to understand what I'm approving than I have a strong... it seems like every team.
It's meant to strengthen the position of the school board and school district to clarify what community groups can represent as their needs.
Okay.
And this will come back for a second reading. So if you have additional questions, feel free to let Ms. Yamashita know.
Yeah, I can add to Friday Focus the Gamut background information, Mr. Clausen. I unfortunately did not bring, I usually have a purple and red folder with me. I accidentally left it at my desk, so I cannot read it off to you tonight like I usually would. I apologize, but I will put that copy in the Friday.
Can you just maybe share how many, like, do we have 50 or 150 or 500 of these?
I would be
not now. In the Friday Focus, that would be context.
It would be a number way more closer to generally elementary schools have one school connected organization. Middle schools generally have one school connected organization. High schools generally have three different connected organizations. So we're talking more like 20 approved district school organizations across our district.
Sorry, one more. So those 20, do they need to now go through board approval since they weren't board approved before?
I do not interpret that it would be retroactive to the groups that are already operating unless someone brought forth a concern.
Okay.
But I could double check with our legal team.
That'd be great. Thank you. I
don't believe my interpretation when I read it was not that we need to retroactively go and approve all the groups that we have. I'll double check that.
Anything else? All right. The next one has to do with administering medication.
So this is our first reading of Board Policy 5141.21, Administering Medication and Monitoring Health Conditions. And it is specifically updating some of the language with the help of Gamut and our nurse, Grace Van Doren and Chris Dowler. And it is specifically trying to address the needs around
EpiPen use at school, voluntary training for staff and how to use EpiPens at school, and the naloxone, basically the opioid antagonists that are those nasal sprays should someone be having an opioid overdose on our campuses. And it also calls out and maintains the current, our current board position of prohibiting the administration of medical cannabis at our school sites.
Is there anyone from the public with questions or comments on this? Seeing none, anyone from the board? Okay, so we'll come back for a second. Yes, Mr. Klaus.
So in the second paragraph, the blue edit
is from Nurse Grace and Mr. Dowler and okay. I.
So that basically, the intention of that blue edit is to say,
students may self-administer medication if they have the parent permission to self-administer and an official doctor's note stating how they are to self-administer. And the medication is labeled in its original appropriate container.
So we changed it from Gamut saying that the district could administer to saying the student can self-administer. Is that what that means, or am I reading it wrong?
The way Gamut had written it is each student had to request district permission to self-administer, and we just shifted it so that it reads that if a student has these things in place, they may self-administer.
Okay, thank you.
So would that be like an asthmatic student who has an albuterol inhaler that they carry in their backpack, and if they get short of breath, they can administer that themselves if they have these things in place?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah,
diabetic students as well, if they're on a pump, may also self-administer their insulin. Again, with all of the right things in place.
Especially with the EpiPen.
Anyone from the public wishing to talk to us on this? Are your everyone's questions answered? Mr. Banfield.
And so a school site would have, the given school site where the student is, would have that documentation and file in the student's file. So it'd just be all there and set up.
That's accurate. I would like to highlight another blue change that is in the middle of what is page 2, where there's the yellow part about option 2. We also added in blue, in addition, that under administration of medication by school personnel, when allowed by law, medication prescribed to a student by an authorized healthcare provider may be administered by a school nurse. We added licensed nurse or trained unlicensed school personnel. So there are very specific ed code requirements about asking our staff if they would like to participate in voluntary trainings like those EpiPen and Narcan administrations. And that would be who is, like, as a kindergarten teacher, I may be a trained unlicensed to do medication personnel, but may still give medication.
And I think this is important in some of our medically fragile classes and some of our special education classes where our students have medical needs as well.
We also were just discussing with Dr. Puccia how we are going to update and systematize the way we are notifying our school staff that they have the right to opt in or opt out to this voluntary training in EpiPens and Narcan. And we're going to do that through our onboarding HR paperwork, and then linked to that will be the training materials that they can engage in right away as they're hired and employed with us. And then at the beginning of next school year, all of our staff will get that in their beginning of the school year notifications. We've already done through our school health staff at individual school sites the trainings for this school year.
Anything else? All right. And lastly, differential graduation standards?
So this board policy is specifically related to students with disabilities that are receiving a free and appropriate public education. And sometimes we need to do modifications to the district's regular course based on the student's IEP. And so it outlines how students can achieve a certificate of educational achievement or a certificate of educational completion. So these are only for students that are eligible to take the California Alternative Assessment. These are students that are typically highly impacted. They've been receiving a modified education oftentimes before they reach high school. And this is talking about how they can earn a certificate of completion as opposed to a traditional high school diploma. And it also protects their right that they shall be eligible to participate in the graduation ceremonies and relevant other celebratory activities of students that have achieved graduation.
Any questions or comments by the public? All right, Mr. Unger.
Well, I think
Oh, excuse me, we do have someone from the public. You need to come up to the podium and state your name. And
sorry, my name is Rachel Calderwood. I'm a more intensive TK and Kinder SDC teacher in the district. My question is, so would those students who currently fit that population, would they still be capable of selecting to get a diploma instead? Okay. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, that's a great important question. These determinations about kind of the end of students' educational careers in our public school setting are often made in collaboration with parent agreement as IEPs are developed and written and agreed to. And we often have conversations with parents as we are developing IEPs about what kind of graduation certificate their child will be eligible for based on the type of program they're enrolling in and the supports that they require. So we do absolutely make sure parents are involved in the discussion about which type of end degree their children receive.
Okay, I just want to make sure that's all the public comment we have. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Unger. Well,
and I think it also reminds us that students are still eligible for special education until they're 22, yeah, whether they get a certificate of completion, and as I read this, whether they get a modified high school diploma or not.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay, we'll be bringing these back, and I will do my best to add additional information in the Friday focus as requested.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Right, we're moving on to the action consent calendar agenda. Please let me know if you'd like anything pulled. 11.01, approval of certificated and classified personnel items. 11.02, acceptance of donations. 11.03, approval of 2026-27 instructional calendar. 11.04, approval of minutes from October 15, 2024. 11.05, annual renewal of services for Super Co-op, a California USDA foods cooperative. 11.06, proposed revisions to board policy 5113, absences and excuses, second reading. 11.07, proposed revisions to board policy 5116.1, intra-district open enrollment, second reading. 11.08, proposed revisions to board policy 5145.3, non-discrimination harassment, second reading.
I move approval of items 11.01 to 11.08, and I would just remind the board that on 11.05, the representative from the California USDA Food Cooperative is Dr. Betty Crocker.
And a second?
I'll second.
Right, we have a motion by Mr. Unger, a second by Mrs. Roger. Mr. Unger?
Yes.
Mrs. Roger?
Yes.
Mr. Banfield?
Yes.
Mr. Buckman?
Yes.
Mr. Clausen?
Yes.
Yes, all right, thank you. Next we have anything for advanced agenda? And finally, we have board reports. Mr. Banfield.
So the other day, Jill and I went and saw the last showing of Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And I'm looking at the playbill, and I recognize the name of the student who played Aslan, former student of mine. So I went up to him, and here's this 10'9" young man. Gave me this big bear hug. It was so neat. Oh, just love that kind of stuff, don't you? It's really fun.
Thank you. Mr. Unger.
Yeah, I also went to see The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe last Saturday, and it was really fun. It was just great. And when they talked about it being a student presentation, that it was a student director, and basically the staff just kind of facilitated the play. It was really pretty. Yeah, the director, and so there were some people that pitched in and tried to make sure that. And then, like a bunch of us, I went to the Los Ranchos National Blue Ribbon Celebration. I think that was pretty darn exciting and fun.
So, you know, the only thing I'm going to add, and this is not the happiest thing to note, but the president-elect has named Linda McMahon an ex-professional wrestling executive to lead the Department of Education. That came through just a little while ago. So we all owe it to our children to be paying attention to what happens at the federal level with education in the coming years. So thank you, everybody. Have a great Thanksgiving.